Good afternoon, everyone. So Scott Brinker is not here, but his Martech super graphic has made an appearance more than a couple of times. Anyone knows how many logos are there on that map? Ankush, not you, because that was there on your slide. Anyone? So 7040 logos, that's the latest one. And it's been increasing rapidly. So what that graphic reinforces is that this Martech marketplace is evolving very rapidly, and it is a complex one at that. Right now, I don't disagree with that notion, but I do believe that there is a scope for some simplification there. We need to simplify that complexity, and that's what I am, so we've got some strong ideas of our own based on which we have some, we have learned from our customers what the core pieces of a MarTech stack should be. We learned those things from our customers, and some of that is what I'm going to share with you in next 15 minutes or so. So this is a rather modest graphic of ours. I say modest because it has fewer number of categories as well as a fewer number of vendors. This is essentially, we are using a subway paradigm to basically organize all the vendors depending on the functionality that they sell. So there are 8 lines here. I'm not sure if you can read them, but there are 8 colors that you can probably make out. The first light, the web content management in light blue, digital asset management, marketing automation and campaign execution, and customer relationship management. These have been our traditional lines. I think they have been there for a long time, and we have covered them for a long time. And I would like to believe that that most people here are pretty comfortable with those lines. The next 4 lines, which is starting with orange, customer data platforms, journey orchestration engines, operations hubs, and content platforms, are some newer technologies that are seeing a lot of traction these days amongst customers who are exploring newer things in marketing technology. Customer data platform, we've talked about, some speakers have talked about it. Essentially, if I stick to the subway paradigm, this is like a line which is perpetually under construction. And we are seeing, we are having to add new stations, remove stations, merge stations, almost on a weekly basis. Journey orchestration engines is for those sort of vendors that provide capabilities for managing customer journeys. So things like decision making related to what happens when a customer abandons your shopping cart, for example. Operations hubs are like platforms that allow you to sort of provide a cockpit or a command center. So you want to manage all this. And finally, the content platforms are sort of platforms that, think of them as a cross between headless EMS, digital asset management, and marketing asset management. We'll talk a bit more about them as we go forward, but essentially this graphic gives you an idea of what are the core technologies or the core areas that are required for enterprises that are planning to build their own omnichannel marketing stack. If you notice, there are several vendors here. I come this side. So there are several vendors here who are present on multiple lines. Right now, those are the vendors who provide solutions across those multiple lines. And if you notice, most of them are suite vendors. So there's Microsoft there, there's Acoustic there. Acoustic is what IBM was earlier for our purposes. There's Adobe there, there's Oracle there, and there's Salesforce there. There are probably a couple of others, but these are the main suite vendors. And suite vendors provide solutions across multiple lines. And because they do that, there is a perception amongst enterprises looking at these kind of technologies that these solutions will be able to provide them an end-to-end solution or a solution for all kinds of marketing activities. So that's really the context. And that brings me to our first set of best practices related to building versus buying an omnichannel stack. Now, because those vendors provide solutions across multiple categories, customers start believing that if they just license a suite vendors, all their digital marketing problems will be solved. We have learned otherwise. We have consulted with several clients, and our research really shows otherwise. There is no such thing an end-to-end solution or an out-of-the-box platform. So the thing is that most of the suite vendors have really created their solutions by way of acquisitions, right? So when they have acquired products, even though they package it as a single marketing cloud or a marketing solution or a whatever platform, under the hood, they are really different products with different architectures, different repositories, and so on and so forth. So an out-of-the-box solution or an omnichannel platform does not exist. You need to look for best-of-breed solutions to build your own omnichannel stack. Now, I'm not suggesting that you should discard the suites altogether. There are several use cases for when suites are important. So if you do license a suite, keep these two things in mind. Look at the individual products within the suite for their own merit. So don't just select them just because they are a part of suite. So let's say you want email marketing and you have licensed Salesforce. Don't just think of using ExactTarget just because it comes part of the license. You need to evaluate ExactTarget for what it is on its own merit. Secondly, like I said, most suites under the hood are a bunch of different products. So don't assume that they are well integrated. You should plan for additional efforts and resources just to make sure that they all work together in the way that you want to. So let's build a bit on what we have just discussed. This is a sort of stack model that many of us are familiar with. We have seen a lot of customers who've used these kind of stack models and built sophisticated solutions on top of them. So like all stack models, you have channels on top, there's social, email, website, etc. And then you have some production, interaction, and delivery services like e-commerce or page layout or mobile middleware. And then you have the content and engagement platforms there, you know, marketing automation, WCM, DAM, etc. And finally, you have the backend repositories or backend systems underneath. Now, while this kind of a stack architecture is pretty popular, I think as we move from 2010s to 2020s, this kind of a model is really dead-ended, right? And there are very specific reasons for why such a model is dead-ended. In spite of what gurus will tell you, this is a very siloed model, right? So it is more enterprise-centric rather than customer-centric. So what that means is that because there are multiple backend repositories, the data gets stuck in those backend repositories, and because of that, it is inconsistent, it is inaccessible, and certainly not actionable. If it is split across multiple repositories, it's tough to action it, right? In addition, all your content, experiences, and rules are platform specific. So what does that mean? You might have a set of personalization rules specific to your website. You might have another set of personalization rules that are specific to your email marketing. And right now, there is no real way to align them or standardize them. You have to have them twice. And you have multiple channels, more channels than these two. You've got to define your personalization rules at every channel. So those sort of rules are platform specific rather than enterprise-wide or system-wide. And because of that, your delivery logic or decision logic gets split across different channels. So what goes on your website is decided by your website content management system or a WCM. What goes in an email campaign is decided by your email marketing software and so on. So decision logic is split. And therefore, your customers and prospects are not able to enjoy an integrated or a consistent experience. Now, there are several symptoms of these problems. We'll not go into those details, but you can refer to the slide later. Essentially, the point here is that right now, with this kind of stack model, it is impossible to create a consistent customer experience and a unified approach to engagement across channels. So what do we do about these problems? And we have learned some best practices based on our consulting and research. What we need to do is to rethink the stack model. And what does that mean? The first point there is that we need to remove all those silos that we just discussed, right? So removing those silos could be in terms of data being split across multiple repositories. Those silos could be in terms of user experience, so multiple user experiences, multiple types of user interfaces, and so on. In order to be able to do that, we need to avoid any experiences and rules that are platform specific. So we can't have one set of rules dictating personalization for a website, another set of rules dictating personalization for email management, right? And if we have to do that, we really have to think hard about where those capabilities exist. Should they exist in your digital experience layer? So for example, should personalization exist in a CMS platform? Should personalization exist in a portal platform? Maybe not. Should segmentation exist in a CRM platform? Maybe not. Right, so the idea here is that we need to abstract those key foundational services away from channel-specific products. So move them from WCM, move them from e-commerce, move them from analytics, and bring them in a layer of their own. So essentially, omnichannel means key services move lower in your stack. The idea here is to, so 2010 stack, we need to rethink of that by removing silos, and this is what it might look like. You still have those channels and interaction and delivery service and so on, but you have another layer here called enterprise foundation services. I'll blow that up. So essentially, we are suggesting that you abstract all those services that we talked of into a layer of its own, and these are the four that we think are relevant for building an omnichannel stack platform. And we'll talk a bit more about them as well. They are same as what you saw in the map earlier, but this time with more details. So customer data platform is for doing a 360 degree view of customers and doing segmentations, etc. Journey orchestration and decisioning is sort of a traffic management system. So you want to make a decision based on what a customer is doing or where are they in a customer journey, so you want to take decisions based on that. Omnichannel content hub is for publishing content to all those channels. So essentially, it things like a snippet of an offer, or maybe an audio or a video image for some advertisement, right? So all those kind of things need to be managed separately and not within each of those platforms. And to manage all this sort of a cockpit, you need to have operation hubs. So essentially, the idea that we are suggesting is that you need to split and decouple your MarTech services while keeping in mind this separation of concerns, right? And here are some suggestions based on that. So all the services related to customer management, so 360 degree unified profiles, extended attributes, segmentations, all these should be extracted into what is known as customer data platforms or CDPs. Once you have all that data, you actually need to activate that. You need to do something with it. You need to run campaigns, right? And all that, you need to do personalization, right? And all those sort of services get abstracted into what we call journey orchestration engines, journey orchestration systems. Abstract all the services related to content, so not just web content, but all other types of content, your snippets of content, your reusable content, and make it as a single source of truth for content across channels. So that's what goes into OCPs or omnichannel content platforms. Have the operations hub for collaboration, creation, scheduling, internal, external resource management, making sure all your campaigns are running, and that kind of stuff. So I would have loved to spend some more time on these four areas, but we don't have the time right now. I have left these slides for your reference in case you want to go through them later. But we'll move on to our last set of best practices, which is really for the product selection itself. Now, they are not specific to digital marketing, But they are very relevant to digital marketing. Most of them are self-explanatory, and I won't go into each of them. But I'll pick up the point number two, which is about using a scenario-based approach for selection instead of a functionality-based approach. Now, what does that mean? We have seen a lot of customers, when they start evaluating their products, they come up with these kinds of Excel sheets with hundreds of rows for functionality, and then some way to rank them, and if they want to make it more sophisticated, they'll put some weightage and put some more math there, basically. And in the end, what you get is a vendor with score 7.78 being better than another vendor with score 6.52 or something like that, right? And that doesn't make sense. So I'm not suggesting you discard this. I'm saying you use this, but don't use it as the only way to evaluate products. Instead, supplement it with what we call is a scenario-based approach. So what a scenario is essentially a business use case written in a language that you can understand, your people can understand. So here's an example of a scenario. It uses names that you understand, so your colleagues' names, your employees' names. It uses locations that are relevant to you, and it uses description that is based on what you do in a day-to-day work life, right? So when you do that and then you evaluate those products for their support of these kind of scenarios, you will be able to better select products that are more suitable for you. Every product will get a tick mark for the functionality, but the way they support your scenarios, it is what will make them different. Okay, that's really all that I had to say. Final points, I think again self-explanatory, but couple of important points there. Don't believe the vendor hype. If a vendor tells you they can do everything, they probably can't. So do your own testing, evaluate them well, and then take decisions. Invest low and simplify high. So simplify your top layers, simplify your WCM, simplify your CMS, simplify your email, et cetera, email marketing, et cetera, and invest in a layer below that. So invest in the foundational services that can then serve the layers on top of them. Finally, platforms and vendors are not in themselves omnichannel. So no platform is omnichannel. A vendor selling you an omnichannel platform is probably faffing, right? So you need to build a stack that then can become omnichannel. Okay, that's about it. That's all I had for today. Okay.